Okay, can somebody read Jeremiah chapter 4, verse 8? Or maybe, James chapter 4, verse 8. And somebody else will take up Hebrews chapter 3, verse 8 and Hebrews chapter 3, verse 15. Other person will take James chapter 4, verse 8.
Come near to God, and He will come near to you.
Okay.
Wash your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts.
Purify your hearts.
You double-minded.
This is what the scripture says. This is what the scripture talks about a man. You come back to God because you are double-minded. You don't know whom to please. You don't know how, you know, you're confused in your mind. Wash your heart. The problem is your heart. You need to wash your heart. And how do I wash? I have lots of bricks inside. How do I wash? Is the question. So, Hebrews chapter 3.
As the provocation in the day of temptation in the wilderness.
Now, you tell me, what happened in the wilderness? What happened?
People's hearts were hardened, Israelites.
Okay, yeah.
Hearts were hardened.
What did they do? When their hearts were hardened, what happened?
They turned against God.
Can you tell me how they turned against God?
Grumbling.
Okay. Complaining, grumbling, rebellious against, you know, rebellious attitude and all of that. So it all started where? Hardness of heart. How many of them entered Canaan? So what is the result of hardness of heart?
We lose blessings.
Blessings? Is Canaan a blessing? Canaan is the destiny. Canaan is not a blessing. Canaan is the very purpose they came out of Egypt. The hardening of heart, the bitterness in your heart can actually deprive you of your destiny. Can actually take you away, steal the destiny from your life. Jeremiah chapter 17, verse 19. The human heart is more dishonest than anything else. It can't be healed. Who can understand? The Lord says, I look deep down inside human hearts. I see what is in people's minds. I reward a man in keeping with his conduct. I bless him based on what he has done. And out the way the heart is filled, the way he speaks, and the way he talks. When the storms of life hit you, when the storms of health hit you, when the storms of finances hit you, when the storms of relationships hit you, when the storms of addictions like sex, drugs, alcohol hit you, it crumbles. The wall that we built, the wall of our safety that we built on our own lies that we believe, it crumbles, it shatters, it crackles down, and what is remaining is zero. It just falls, and we remain zero. We're all alone. And this rejection brings anger, doesn't it? Bring anger. We feel angry with God. We feel angry with church. We feel angry with friends. We feel angry with our own family, and we want to run away. There are two ways of expressing this anger. In general, this is what psychologists say. You know, we build a stronger wall based on the same lines. And we again break down and we build more stronger wall. More stronger. So, the only remedy for this is the deception need to be replaced with truth. The lies need to be replaced with truth. And the bondage should be replaced with freedom. And And that freedom is what we talk about from now on. How do we get that freedom? What is that freedom? But God says man's heart is so wicked, it can't be healed. How do I do that? Now, think about it. Think about it. I'm not giving you any homework, don't write it down. Okay? That's for the seminar that I do. So you don't have to. Now you tell me, how does this false, thing that we build affect our family? Will we be honest in our family? Do you think we will be? No. Will we be honest in our schools? No. What is the effect of this fallenness on the religion, including Christian religion? We produce dummies. We produce fakes. We produce clones. No original Christian. No one with life. It's all dullness. It's all rules and regulations. It's all you do this, you do that, you do this, you do that, you do this, you do that, because we want behavior, not the heart. We want outward appearance, not the inward transformation. It affects even our dressing style. We want to be dressed in the English style, right? We want to even wear the, spectacles, believer style. When I was born again, I actually got into a religion. Okay, when the Lord liberated me out of the drugs and alcoholism and pornography, violence, and I just wanted to cover myself with violence to show that I am strong, I can do things, I can perform, and when I submitted my life to the Lord, He liberated me out of that, but I fell in religion. And now I started pleasing the church people, started pleasing the elders and, pastors. Oh my God. Putting up another show every day. If the heart is not dealt with the way it should be, this is what we will do. We will put up a show every day. We will make a mockery of our Lord. Can somebody read Luke chapter 9 verse 47, please? Luke chapter 9 verse 47. Faith. We are called to imitate our Christ. Let's see another verse. Luke chapter 16 verse 15. Luke chapter 16 verse 15. Anna, while they read, can you please go to the next PPT, second PPT. And I'll end with that. Probably I'll take 5 or 6 more minutes and end. Is that okay? Okay. Can somebody read it?
He said to them, "You are the ones who justify yourselves in the eyes of others. But God knows your
hearts." What do we do? We justify. What do we do? We justify ourselves in the sight of
others.
That is what today's Christian world is about. We want to dress up for others, we want to talk for others, we want to behave for others, we want to read scriptures for others, we want to go to church for others, we want to pray for others, we want to read well for others, and study well for everything is for others. But he says, "You are a fool, I know your heart. I know it. I know." So God takes this plumb line and he stands on the wall of your heart. And when he measures, what does he find? Is it based on the truth of his word or the lies that the false prophets sow in your heart? Is it longing for the love that he's got, or is it just a religion? Brother, sister, my younger brother, my younger sister, please don't follow the religion called Christianity. There is nothing in this religion. It is just dust and ashes. You won't get anything in this religion. This is no better than any other religion in the world. It's all about Him. It's all about Jesus. It's all about being restored back to God's own image. It's all about going back to that original form where God can walk with you in the evenings, you know, in the evenings, where God can speak with you, where God can have a pleasant talk with you. If that is missing in your life, I would suggest you leave this religion. I'm sincere about it. If that is missing in your life, I would suggest you just stop following what you're following. So, when you place that plumb line, it swings. If the heart is not right with God, it swings. In two ways it can react. Your heart can react when you receive this storm of finances, the storm of rejection, the storm of ill health, the storm of failure in love, the storm of many things for that matter. You behave in two ways. Number one, you feel rejected. You feel rejected, completely broken. Or the second way is you feel rebellious. Now I will show who I am. Either you feel rejected or you feel what? Rebellious. So if not, it is love. All you have is nothingness. If not, it is the truth and the love of God in your heart. All you have is nothingness. It's zero. And that's what religion is. That's what religion can bring you. Religion can offer you nothingness. Religion can offer you zeroness. Religion can offer you just some thoughts, just some concepts. But you don't have that relationship. You don't have that feel with God. You don't have joy. You don't have peace with God. You don't have value. And you don't feel the worth that you need to feel. And if you are not feeling that love, the peace, the joy, the worth that you should be feeling. I'm sorry, you're living in a religion. But that's not the end of the story. There is a way out. There is a way out. We just need to focus on things, the right things. A passive way of responding to God when you face troubles, when you face these ailments, when you face these storms, and the active or aggressive way of responding. I showed you two pictures in the beginning, right? Those are these two things. The passive way will always be, you know, covering himself, and the active way is rebelliously criticizing with a bow in his hand. So the rejection and rebellion. I don't have time to go through all of that. Those are the examples. The rejection takes you to suicide, whereas the rebellion takes you to murder. I am on the second side. The rejection that I felt in the school, or the rejection I felt in family, the rejection I felt with my friends, made me a murderer or made me aggressive. But in some people, the same rejection can make them suicidal, suiciding their own character, suiciding their own emotions, suiciding their own thoughts, and they go into a shell and cover themselves, and they live a very private life. But inside their heart, they are rebellious to God, they are rebellious to church, they are rebellious to family, they are rebellious to their own self. This is, both are the same, there is no difference. One is outwardly rebellious and the other is inwardly rebellious. One is outwardly murderous and the other is inwardly murderous. It's as simple as that. Effect is same, but presented in a different way. So the Word of God says, the love, the acceptance, the truth, that can bring you back into the family of God. That can restore your heart. That can restore your heart. Let's move ahead a little faster. Now, you see the bricks, right? So when you are on the passive side of the life, those are the bricks that you bring in. Everything that the Word of God says is true, my brother, my sister. The sadness, the self-pity, the self-hatred, depression, apathy, inferiority, insecurity, these are all the outcomes of being rejected by society, being rejected by teachers, being rejected by your parents, being rejected by friends. Okay? And you start believing these things. Look at that. You start building these bricks in your heart. One by one, one by one, one by one. Over a period of time, your wall is so big that you will cover yourself with all of that, and you sit inside comfortably. You think you are safe. But the matter of the fact is, or the fact of the matter is, you are not safe. You are killing inside. Proverbs chapter 20 verse 27 says, the lamp of the Lord searches a man's heart. It searches deep down inside him, and there is nothing but the Word of God. The Word of God, when it searches you, when the Word of God searches you, is it finding these things? The fear of failure, guilt, lack of ability to talk your heart out. Stressful. And the other part is similar, is actually same. Okay, let's do that. Discouraged, okay? Despair. The rebellious side is also similar. There is no difference there. But the only thing is, the appearance or the expression is different. Bitterness, delusion, untouchable, or unteachable, legalistic, control, competitive, superiority, deflation, elation, conceit, anger, and many of the believers suffer this more. The other side are people who are smaller believers. These are big believers, bigger brothers. They suffer this, bitter in heart, unforgiving, delusional. They are not teachable because they say, "I know everything. Oh, give me a break, brother. I've been the elder of this church for 20 years. You teach me?" It's all about legalism. It's all about you do this, you do that, you do this, you do that, you do this, you do that, you do this, you do that. And all of that they do to control people. Competitiveness, superiority, deflation, elation, conceit, and anger. These are the things that make us worse. Our condition worse. We go shattered. One after the other, we build this heart. But when the Lord stands with his Mattapugundu, we fall short. And that is what is called the fallenness of man. That is what is called the depraved nature of man. But here is the good news. Let's go back. Acts chapter 2 verse 46. No, I want you to read faster. Acts chapter 2 verse 46. Acts chapter 14 verse 17. Can somebody read Acts chapter 14 verse 17? Stand in the Word of God and build our life. But let me end with this story. Okay? Our identity. Let's come back to identity. Our identity is mistaken because of the false prophets, because of what people say, because of what society tells us. How many, did I tell you the story of an eagle last time when I was here? Okay. You remember that? You remember that? What was that?
It grew among the chicks, right?
Yes. If everybody remembers that story, then that's what it is. We are growing like ducks, whereas our identity is what? Eagles. Similarly, I'll twist the story a little bit and present you in a different way. Okay, there was a pregnant tiger, and it was very tired, can't go and hunt. There was this green, lush green grass. It came there, sat there, so tired, but it's very hungry, want to eat, closed its eyes, and he was just dreaming. How good it will be if I have a small lamb coming to my mouth and offering itself. And it was dreaming like that, which won't happen in general. After that, it opened the eye and it actually saw the lamb right there in front of it, and it was eating the grass. Jumped on the lamb and it forgot that it's pregnant. It forgot. And in that process, she gave birth, and not realizing because of the food, after a long time she got food, so she ran into the food, but the little you know, cup, it just stayed there. And the other lambs that were staying there said, okay, we'll make it a lamb. Same story again. And this lamb, you know, these lambs made this tiger a vegetarian. Is it possible? Kadal varnete, urkinal. Okay, kadal. So it made it vegetarian. Now, this lamb, this tiger lamb is growing. Tiger lamb is also walking like the lambs, eating the same things that the tigers, you know, the lambs eat. In general, do they do? No, story, everything happens. So after some time, another tiger saw it. It came to the green grass and it was dreaming, okay, how about a small lamb in my mouth? Opened the eyes and it saw the tiger. But it was eating the grass. Got amazed, what is this? And it forgot all the other lambs that are there. Hungry, but don't want to eat it because this is so amazing. Went to him. He said, oh, ne chinna chinna gorre unnadi tinese kani ikkada patti kottese kani appu pain vandu nenu chachipothanu edo chinna what you might not do. And he decided that he wants to remind him who he is actually. Slapped him on his face, dragged him to the nearby water place, and he said, okay, drink the water now.
Okay.
And he wanted to drink the water and he saw it. He saw what? He saw the tiger. Oh, I look like you. You fool. You, that's what you are. Come back to your real senses. Come back to your original form. So it's all about coming back to the original form. We fell. Sin is in our heart. Sin is not what we do. Sin is what is there in the heart. So this sin, if we don't forgive ourselves, if we don't let it go, if we don't pour it out, if we don't realize that there is a problem in the heart, we will never break this shell, my brother. We will never break this wall and come out. The only thing we can do is the truth of the Word of God, which searches the bones and marrows and the spirit and the soul and brings out the truth, brings out the light. And it shows you're a lion, you're a tiger, you're not meant to be one, you're a lamb. So tonight, I want to challenge you, when you go to bed tonight, I want you to write down all those faults or the lies that you have been hearing since your birth. It may be that you are not beautiful, it may be that you are not smart, it may be that you don't do maths well, it may be that you know you're good for nothing, you don't speak English well, you know, these are all lies that the devil wants to put you down. The devil wants to suppress you with these lies, whereas the Spirit of God wants to stir your heart and break those walls and bring you out, because that's what the Word of God is. Can somebody read Acts chapter 8 verse 37? Acts chapter 8 verse 37. And somebody else will read Acts chapter 11 verse 23. Acts chapter 8 verse 37.
And Philip said, if thou believest with all thy heart.
If you can believe with all of your heart.
Thou mayest. And he answered and said, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God.
The first truth that you need to understand is, I want to be liberated by the ministry of the Word of God, who is Jesus Christ. I want to believe in Him. And we all believed. We all wrote, you know, raised our hands one day or the other. We all got baptized. I'm not talking about that belief. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about giving your heart on a daily basis. Walking with the Lord on a daily basis. Breaking the chains of these, you know, strongholds in your heart on a daily basis, bringing the wicked heart to the Lord on a daily basis and telling God, Lord, I am depressed today because of this false thing that is in my heart. I am disappointed today because somebody said these things to me. I am so upset today because of these things. Whereas the truth is, Lord, I am so controlling to people. I control. That's why people flee from me. I put a lot of burden on people with do's and don'ts and do's and don'ts. That's why people are scared of me. I try to be a good leader because I can be dominating. I'm a good, you know, master because I can have this hunter in my hand and chase people. Both sides. Before you go to bed, if you can write these things, or maybe at least just, you know, form a list in your mind and go to bed, go to the Lord before you go to bed and tell him, Lord, these are the things that I have in my heart. I want you to deal with them. If not today, when will I deal with you? Psalmist says, search my heart, O Lord, and cleanse me. Purify my heart. Because it's a daily process, my brothers, my sisters. It's not that one day I remember all the sins and wrote it on a paper, flushed it in the toilet, and I said, I'm born again now. Well, that's a start, which is good. But what about the walk with the Lord every day? In liberty, in freedom. You know, when a Christian walks, he should walk in freedom. He should walk in confidence that today, if I meet my Lord, I'll be bold and I look at him and I say, Lord, thank you for liberating me. And he paid the price on the cross for all the bricks that you built in your heart. One time, he is able to cleanse you one time, but you are so fallen that you build these walls again and again and again and again. So you have to go back to the Lord again and again, again and again. That is what is walking in liberty, walking in freedom, walking with God. Now here is my question. Are you walking with God every day? Are you aware of your problem? Are you aware of your situation that your heart is wicked? Or you are living in a mask, wearing a mask called religion, thinking that I am super religious, so I am good. Psalmist says, Lord, search me, try me, consume me. Consume me. What does it mean to consume us? When Isaiah saw the Lord in all of his holiness, in all of his glory, he said, cleanse my lips. Oh, wretched I am, I saw you when I lived. That's the holiness of God. And we want to go to that holy God with this heart that I showed you just now. Filthy, filthy heart with all sorts of malice, anger, hatred, competition, controlling attitude, insecurity. And these are all not just for young people, for all of us. Do we go to the Lord with this? If you harden your heart today, it is possible that you may even get deprived of your destiny. Don't harden your heart when the Lord speaks to you. Bring your heart to God. Tell him, Lord, here it is. Replace it, Lord, with flesh. This is so hard as stone. I don't want to continue with this. Can you be circumcised today, as Romans chapter 2 says? Circumcised in heart. In olden times, people used to get circumcised physically, which is a chaya, which is a you know, shadow. But the reality is, the Lord wants to circumcise your heart. He wants to take off the unnecessary skin. James says your heart is fattened, comforted, fattened with all these things. And he will send the storm and it will break down. But the Spirit of God can lift you up. Shall we close our eyes and look to the Lord? Hebrews chapter 4 verse 12 says, the Word of God judges intentions and thoughts. The secrets of our hearts are disclosed in front of God. When we approach the Word of God, when we approach the prophecy, when we approach the fellowship, the secrets of our heart come out. Brother and sister, please don't think about other brother, other sister that have these problems. Either the problem of rejection or the problem of rebellion. Think about you. Are you rebellious to God? Or are you rejecting God? Are you covering yourself in self-pity? Or you are critiquing others to make others feel just the way you feel? Do you still carry the guilt of your guilt and shame of your sin? It's time for you to bring it in front of God. And the cleansing of your heart can happen only with the heartful obedience to the teaching, as Romans chapter 6 verse 17 says. The teaching is when you walk with the Lord on a daily basis, when you confess the wounds of your heart on a daily basis, when you forgive on a daily basis, when you forget on a daily basis, when you restore yourself with God on a daily basis. These are fundamental, my brother and sister. Don't underestimate these things. Oh, these are just small things. Oh, little anger. Oh, little strife. Oh, little, disappointment. What will it do to me? Jesus says, I see you. I see your heart. It's filthy, it's rusty, it's smelly. Would you be renewed in your mind today when you go out? I want you to identify yourselves as a cleansed man, as a cleansed woman, understanding that your heart has got a problem, but there is a solution, and that is Jesus Christ. He is born. He can cleanse your heart. Are you giving your heart to Him on a daily basis? Cleaning it on a daily basis? Walking with Him on a daily basis? Now here is the question. Whom do you live for? Whom do you live for? Do you live under one audience called God, or you live for others? There is just one audience that can reward or punish you. Everything else is just a drama.